It's Steven Tyler and Joe Perry, ladies and gentlemen. Come on out, fellas.
Joe's cool, he's looking out, taking his time, Joe, come and sit down, have a seat, relax.
Well, I'm excited you're here. I'm a big Aerosmith fan.
Oh, beautiful. What's your favourite song?
I like all your songs and I love your roller coaster as well. You know there's an Aerosmith roller coaster, did you know that? So, exciting news for Aerosmith fans. New album is out November the 5th. First album for, is it 10 years?
10 years.
Why so long for a new
album? Well, it hasn't really taken that long. It's just we've been busy getting ready.
So you've been off doing other things as well, I guess.
Oh, yeah, touring.
And we've been looking at it more like it's taken 40 years to get here.
So that's how long you guys have been together for then, I guess. What year was it? How old were you when you first met each other?
Well, we don't remember that date. We're swimming in the...
No.
I don't know. 71.
Yeah, 18, 19 years old, maybe.
And you were both in different bands, weren't you, initially?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I was busy in New York, and he was up in New Hampshire.
Yeah.
And what was it about each other's music or style that made you think, OK, this is going to what we should get together?
Well, you know, I heard his bands after I'd given up on all of mine. And my father played classical music, went to Juilliard. So when I heard him rocking out, I thought, you know, it's like the chocolate and peanut butter to make the Reese's.
He had a schooled approach to things and knew how to keep things in tune, you know, relatively, you know, keep things on the beat and everything. And I was more like, I just want to turn it up, play loud, and have fun. And that was it. And so the two of us together, it kind of, just like you said, it just
kind of the discipline and the anarchy kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly.
My better half.
But you guys, I mean, you've been very close all this time, and you've also had terrific fallings out, haven't you?
Well, yeah. It happens, you know.
If it wasn't for the cracks, there'd be nowhere for the light and sun to shine through. You think?
It's a nice way to put it.
Is that getting off from you? No, of course we've been at each other. You know, it's, you know, 40 years with guys. It's bad enough with women. Now hold on.
The last falling out, I guess, would this be fair to say, was when you accepted the job as one of the judges on American Idol, but didn't think to pick up a phone and tell one of your oldest friends?
No, that's not it at all. They were just jealous I was sitting next to J-Lo. He had a big crush on her.
No, I don't think so. No, I think it was more what you said. It was that. That's pretty much it. Actually, I was happy for you, you know, because it was a perfect thing. You got to, you know, dump out all your one-liners and stuff. It was a great job for you.
And not put them into the songs for us, huh?
Well, that part of it, no, I never thought it took away from... Half of them are Aerosmith songs.
You know, I don't want to start an argument again.
Look, we're not fighting.
Yeah, okay.
No, this is normal.
Okay, but you weren't told, were you? You found out the way everyone did. You found out on the internet.
Yeah. Or however, you know, I mean, I don't know, I read it somewhere.
And 2 months prior to that, they were looking for another lead singer, so I figured I'd fix them good, right?
Really? Were you?
Well, after I read in the paper, that he was trying out for Led Zeppelin.
Okay, I see what's happening here, because you're saying, well, I did this bad thing because you did this. And he's saying, yeah, but I did this because you did this. So yeah. What did he do before that made you think you might want to join Led Zeppelin? This just goes back.
It goes back a long way. 42 years.
Take it back. Let's see if we can get to first girlfriend. Was it the first girlfriend, Joe? In fact,
I was just thinking about that today.
Because
there is a connection there.
Positively, see this? How epiphanous.
So who stole whose first girlfriend from the other?
Why don't we get this out now? We were in an apartment building and we all lived together for once, and I thought that was a secret to make it.
Yeah.
That was a secret. Band being together, wake up in the morning and write songs. And we did, and I looked at Joe and I said, wow, man, we're together finally, we're all living here. And he moved out in 2 weeks with his girlfriend. And I've never forgiven him.
The girl was part of his past.
Oh, I see. So his old girlfriend.
Well, I don't know. You never really girlfriend.
I never really told you what happened with that.
Well, no. You know what? I don't really care. Don't matter.
It came out in a song called Love in an Elevator.
Okay.
No, it was actually I Don't Want to Kiss Your Thing.
Let's talk a little bit about the many years of partying and drug use. Because you were kind of pretty famous for that as well. I mean, fortunately, the music was always the big thing, but...
Well, I mean, it was part in time. Remember, we grew up in the 70s and the war was on and it was like, make love, not war. And it was very apropos. It was the thing to do. We just took it to the excesses, you know.
When we talk about excesses, though, what kind of excesses are we talking about? Did you ever do drugs before a show, during a show?
Uh-huh. During a show,
yeah.
Of course,
during the show.
I think it's suffice to say we snorted up half of Peru, so. You know, proud of it, not proud of it. You know, it took me down.
Yeah.
But it also got us through. The only way out is through. By 1979, we played every state in America, including the state of Oblivion, 9 times.
When you were doing the drugs on stage, were we talking about cocaine on stage? Is that what we're talking about, or other substances?
You know, lots of Jack
Daniels. Well, that was, Jesus, a long time ago. You know what I mean?
But where would you do it on stage? Because you couldn't do it in front of the audience.
Well, right in back, there's space.
Well, did you have a room, or what did you have, like a tent there. You went into, yeah. A little cocaine
no,
tent, just... or a little hut? Or a TARDIS? Where did you do... Where, was it laid out for you by someone else?
Yes,
or?
If you really want to get specific,
so the way we did it was you'd take a cup, paper cup, and put a straw in it, put your whatever it was, and you would turn around and pretend to have a sip of whatever was in the cup.
But you'd actually be snorting...
But you just had to just miss your mouth by about this much. And, let's talk about ping pong.
Are you bored of talking about drugs?
Yeah, we don't want to talk about that.
But you can see why it's fascinating to those of us who haven't been through life to that excess, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Well, when you live on stage and you're used to moments where the curtain's dropping at Madison Square, you're not going to go back and play ping pong, even though we grew up doing that. So we're going to whomp your ass, okay?
Well, don't look at me. I'm not saying I'm a ping pong expert. I'm saying Mitchell has got
the balls.
The fearsome skills.
Has he got the balls?
He has got the balls. Okay, we're going to take a break. I'm going to be talking to Joe and Stephen more after this, and we're going to have that table tennis showdown with Mitchell. Let's see if he's as good as he says.
Yes.
Don't go away. Stick around. Guys, I didn't know the guys hadn't seen the album yet. This is the new album. It's out November the 5th, and
that's
you hadn't
it.
Seen the Steve or the artwork.
We had not seen the artwork. You know, I was in a deli after a couple of the sessions in L.A. recording this album, and someone in there showed me a picture that Slash had drawn of Aerosmith when he was like 13.
So he was a fan.
He was a big, big fan, and I said, "Can I buy that?" He wouldn't sell it, but we used it on the album. So
that's
there it
by
is.
Slash from Guns N' Roses, or ex
Slash from Guns N' Roses.
When he was a kid.
Yeah, yeah. Great little story.
Now, are you guys touring again? Are you going back on the road with this?
We are in 2 months.
Okay.
Two months.
Without wishing to seem, you know, odd about this, but you're kind of, obviously, we're all getting older.
Mm.
You're 62 and 64 now, is
yeah.
that right? And you look incredible.
Thanks.
For those days. I think everyone would agree. I mean, for, you know, incredible. But what's it going to be like touring at this age? It's going to be a different experience when you were first young guys on the road, I guess. What kind of, I mean, do you have to nap, or what do you do to keep...
Actually, he does that a lot.
I love a nap.
I don't know how to do that yet. You know, go to the gym and so forth and just work out, but, you know, I live vicariously through the audience, you know, and they just kick my ass after 2 weeks on tour and I'm 12 again. I mean, just in every essence of the word, it's like, you know, I'm mentally six as it is anyway. So I grow up a little and I revert back to, you know, it's just this good exercise. It's the best. I lose 4 pounds a night and it's just...
And what do you eat? You have to, I guess you have to look after your body more than you...
Shit and splinters.
That
boiled owl and oatmeal.
Well, you know what I love about Aerosmith? Well, you don't, I'm going to tell you. You know what you're getting with Aerosmith. You know what you're getting with an Aerosmith album. You know you're going to get, it's going to be classic, kind of big, beefy rock and roll.
I wish I had that kind of
big, soaring vocals, you know, and you've still got it, which is remarkable.
Mm.
But the tunes you write are great. And there's something about it, you know it's an Aerosmith song as soon as it starts. It's almost, is there a formula? How do you get that together? What do you look for in each other's writing for that?
Well, it starts with a lick, you know. If he's got something up his sleeve, and I just lay down on it, and then we think about what that's going to be like to play live. You know, what would do to the audience, and how we've always felt as though we were the fire that people danced around, and we might as well write songs that would fuel that. It's really quite simple, and more often than not, I'm singing something in the stratosphere, and he'll say, remember, we got to play this every night for the next 10 years.
And we know, you know, we've got to bring this out in front and entertain an audience, and that's, again, we come from that era where that was it. I mean, you went out there and either you did it or you didn't, and so it all comes from the rhythm.
Let's have a look. This is the new single from Aerosmith. I don't know if it's been seen. Is it What Could Have Been Love?
What Could Have Been Love?
What Could Have Been Love. Have a look at this. It's Aerosmith immediately. I close my eyes and see you lying in my bed. Still dreamed of that day. Like a classic rock single already.
That's a great chorus, man. Wow. When it hits and bangs into that chorus, it's like, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, God.
Yeah.
Are you going to bring the tour over here? Do you think that you will do the UK again?
Hopefully next year.
Yeah.
So next year.
That's the plan.
And all you guys have still got going on. I don't know if you saw the pictures of the Rolling Stones recently, but it looks like Bill Wyman's been kidnapped and replaced by someone's nan.
Still plays great, though.
I bet he still plays great. Well, he's not in the band anymore. He doesn't have to. Yeah. And that brings me to a question. I'm hoping, I mean, I'm guessing you're just going to keep on going, but do you have a kind of game plan? Do you have a kind of year when you think, okay, we're going to stop then, or...?
No, there's no finish line with us, and we made a vow to be the last band standing.
But it's great. You've still got the rock look going on. You know, convincingly, you're still getting away
with
it.
Come on, we've been working at it for so long. We're going to change it. Change now? I mean, come on.
Okay, I've loved having you on the show. I'm just a huge fan of your work, and it's great to meet you guys as well. Before you go, though, are you up for this table tennis challenge?
So up.
Okay, let's bring the table tennis out here right now. But first, let's say thank you to Stephen Tyler and Joe Perry, ladies and gentlemen. The last band standing. Okay.
Thanks.
David, are you ready for this?
Yep.
I think he is.
Come on.
Okay, will you welcome back out? I'm going to ask Bradley to come out and David Mitchell. Come on out, guys. Let's see what skills you've got on the table tennis court. Choose your weapon, gentlemen. You're going to play with the red or the black side? Joe, you're not playing.
All right, I'll give it a try.
Come on, you can do it. David. Okay, who wants what side? What side do you want to be on?
It doesn't matter to me.
Thank you.
Okay. Are we doing doubles?
You know what, I think, actually, I think it's David against all of us. One at a time.
Yeah.
Come on. Okay.
I haven't presented myself as particularly good.
Well,
I just made the mistake of beating you.
Several times. You beat everyone that night. Okay. So, do you want to have a little warm-up first, guys?
A little warm-up.
Right. Okay, just a gentle warm-up.
Nice.
Wow. Wow, he saved you then. Okay.
Nice.
Oh.
Wow. But I've never seen this double-handed thing.
Bloody hell.
Wow. You're out.
Joe said the same thing to me once.
Do you want to serve or you want to be served too? He's going to serve. Joe's serving. Okay. I think Joe's got some hidden depths here. Oh, well, maybe not. Okay, Bradley. Let's see it.
All right.
Okay.
Come on, Bradley.
Well, good, nice. Cut it off. Yeah, he's warmed up now, I think. I think you've got a challenge. Yes. Oh, yes! Wow, come on. That's pretty good. That's pretty good right there.
Yes!
That was exciting.
Booyah! Come on!
That's
great. Oh, my God. Mitchell. Okay, I think David Mitchell is our champion this evening. But join me in saying congratulations to the ping pong stars of tomorrow. That was a good move at the end there.